So, I was asked to speak about as a golden age. Sometimes we hear, this is a golden age, and if you read the newspaper or listen to the news or see it on your phone, you go, doesn't seem much like a golden age. There's just so much conflict and everything. In the ancient Vedic texts, that describes, and I've spoken about it before, but I'm not sure if you were here then. There's four different, what's called yugas, which are really, really long periods of time, and they're like the seasons, So one season follows another year after year. Some of the seasons seem a little odd, but not really, not very spring-like. But so these time frames, these really, really long periods of time, there's such a yuga, which is the golden age, and Dwapara Yuga, oh sorry, Satya Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, and Kali Yuga. And in each age, from the golden age, then there's kind of like a decline in spiritual principles, in kind of cleanliness and honesty, and just like love and kindness and compassion. And I mean, these are really long periods of time. But the sort of winter of the ages is called Kali Yuga, and that's the age that we're in now. And that's like the worst of the ages, where there's so much chaos and quarrel and confusion, and people bicker about anything. But within this particular Kali Yuga, there is actually what's called a golden age, and it goes for about 10,000 years. And ultimately, what's really important is that whether it's a golden age or whether it's like an iron age, whether it's like a totally shitty time, right, planetary-wise, it's really important for each of us to take care of our own spiritual journey. Lord Chaitanya appeared 500 years ago to teach this process of meditation on a really widespread scale, and is forecast in the ancient Puranas that are, written down eons of time ago, that in this particular Kali Yuga, in every town and village throughout the world, the names of God will be chanted. And sometimes we think, well, what about somebody in some isolated place? Will they hear about the names of God? Will they have an opportunity to grow spiritually? There's so many places in the world that are really, really, really isolated. And God is in the heart of every living being, every living being. And he knows our desires, he knows what we want, and he never forces himself upon anybody, but he has given us a process of chanting these sacred mantras so that our hearts and minds can become purified and that we can come to be re-established in our relationship with him. And so, for us, we've been incredibly blessed, really, that we've come in contact with this really simple process of meditation and self-realization, that we can all re-establish our relationship with God and make this our last life and don't come back here and go through yuga after yuga and problem after problem and bits of happiness here and there, but that we can use this amazing opportunity that we have. And we may look and go, well, this opportunity isn't there for everyone. There's all sorts of people who haven't come in contact with, a bona fide spiritual path. But pretty much in every culture, every old culture, there's some acceptance of a supreme power. There's a supreme being. So like in different tribes, if they don't talk about God, they definitely talk about there being a higher power. because they're very much aware of the power of something greater than themselves. You know, if you're living in a situation where you're dependent upon the weather, you know, you don't have electricity and you can't just put a heater on or an air conditioner on or something, you know. You can't just go buy veggies from the local shop, you know, no matter what the weather conditions have been. You know, there's people that are very much aware of their smallness on the planet, you know, and the powers that are greater than them. And so, you know, that maybe they'll worship the rain god, or they'll worship the sun god, or they'll, you know, worship some sort of power above them to help them have good crops or to help them in, you know, in some way or another. And so, you know, if a person doesn't come in contact with, you know, bona fide spiritual practice in this lifetime, you know, maybe next lifetime. God is not cruel, he's not mean, he's not selective in who he gives his love or who he gives his help to. You know, it's available for everyone, but he knows our heart and he knows what we want. And he never interferes with that. You know, we always have freedom to choose. He's the most sensitive of all living beings. I mean, sometimes we might think, oh, I'm quite sensitive about, you know, people's attitudes or how people treat me or something. I'm quite sensitive, but compared to God, we haven't got much sensitivity at all. He's like the supreme in everything. And just as you find it difficult to have a relationship with somebody who doesn't really want to know about you, you know, we've all had experiences of that, of, you know, trying to relate to somebody and they're not interested, you know, then God is not going to force himself upon us. He's not going to force himself upon us if he knows we're actually not interested. You know, we don't really want to have a relationship. Or maybe we want a little bit of a relationship, but, you know, keep it kind of distant. You know, I really want to do everything I want to do, and I just want you there for when things get really bad. You know, like the old saying, you know, there's no atheist on an operating table. You know, and so it's important that no matter what kind of situation we're in, no matter what yuga we're in, no matter whether we're in a golden age or a copper age or an iron age or whatever it is, we each have an opportunity to take our spiritual life seriously and to use this amazing, precious gift of a human form of life to come to re-establish our loving relationship with God. And really often, that's brought about by things aren't going so well in our life. You know, we don't usually start questioning, you know, who am I, why am I here, what the hell is going on, until things are not great. You know, it's like, you know, maybe we suffer from depression or anxiety, or maybe, you know, something's happened to someone we love. And you know, we start to question more about life, whereas when things are going fine, you know, we don't. And so, you know, even if we're living in a golden age, that can be a sidetrack. You know, we can just get immersed in all the good things happening. And so, yeah, we don't want to lose sight of the situation we're in, the opportunity that we've got. And to know that, you know, ultimately, like Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, the ultimate thing for everyone is to re-establish their relationship with God. And he said, that'll bring us the most intense happiness. That's the only happiness that actually satisfies us in the core of our being. So Krishna says in the end of the Bhagavad Gita, just surrender unto me, I will give you all protection. I'll give you protection from your loneliness, from your fears, from your anxieties, from, you know, our troubled mind. God will give us protection. And we may think of that protection being in a certain way, and it may not appear to us like that, but Krishna promises, I will give you all protection. If you surrender unto me, I will give you all protection. So if we're not feeling it, then we can figure, my surrender is not that great. And so, you know, we can't fake surrender. Surrender means love, right? When you surrender to someone, I mentioned this the other night, on Friday night. You know, if you work in a bank and someone comes up with a gun and says, surrender all the money, you know, it's not out of love, right? You just go, sure, here, have it all. But in a loving relationship, you know, we experience, we surrender to that person. We give them our heart. We tell them our, the closest things and our, that we're feeling. And, you know, like you surrender that to that person. You have faith and trust in that person. And then in this world, inevitably, we get disappointed and think, I couldn't trust that person after all. You know, we get hurt. And sometimes we can be lucky and, you know, that relationship is really solid and last till the end of this lifetime. But you know, surrender, so when Krishna says surrender unto me, he's talking about give me your heart, give me your love, and I will give you everything that you need in the core of your being. I will give you full protection. I will give you complete love and complete happiness. And complete, when we talk about happiness, I mean, in this world, we just get little bits of happiness. But in the spiritual world, in a relationship with Krishna, there's complete and total happiness. So that's what we should try and aim for, is to reestablish that relationship. If we're not sure whether God exists, you know, we're kind of feeling a little bit, maybe, maybe not, don't know about this, you know. Just take one step at a time and do things like really look at the world and look at the fact that the sun comes up in a certain pattern and it goes down in a certain pattern. You know, the seasons follow one after another. I remember watching somebody one time. They were, you know, when you go to be served, say like in a bank, for example, and you're looking at them and they're looking at a screen. In this particular situation, I was watching the person's eyes and watching them, you know, follow the screen. And it's like, there's a designer behind that one. You know, just that they being able to see, you know, this is just like a, you know, it's like a, I don't know what you call it, an eye muscle, you know, it's just like, you know, the process of seeing is just like so far out, you know. But there's a person behind that that's seeing. It's not just an eyeball, right? The eyeball doesn't see. It's you, the person inside, and you're using that to see. Right? So if we look around, we can see, I think there seems to be someone in control. There's somebody who designed all this. You know, you look at a flower and you go, my God, you know, the designs of flowers are just phenomenal, you know, and the design of, you know, how a plant takes in food. Or, you know, Carmel and Adrian's daughter just had a baby a couple of weeks ago. And, you know, just how the body works and, you know, have a baby and then the body just produces milk. You know, it's like, do you know what I mean? It's not like she decided, okay, I'm gonna produce some milk after this. You know, and the body just does all this amazing stuff because there's a designer behind it. So God is not just a designer. You know, he's the most fun, the most playful, the most amazing person ever. And he wants to have a loving relationship with each and every one of us. Gives us his holy names that we can chant and we can gradually re-establish that relationship, whether good things are going on or bad things are going on. Thank you.